talk a little bit about the how does the scale-up work and what are the things that it implements. So we call scale-up stands for second principle. So why would we want to go beyond first principle? So most of us, I guess, have at least worked a little bit with first principle simulations, and the idea for this kind of calculation is that they allow us to predict the properties of a material just coming from the fundamental constants, so the charge of the electron, the Planck constant, and so on. And the main idea there is that you solve the Schrödinger equation, or the DFT, you use the condensed equations to solve DFT, and it gives us a lot of information about how the energy surface of, for example, the energy surface of a system is, for the ground is the most. That means that we can obtain, for example, the equilibrium geometry, so we can predict the kind of geometry a system can have. We can predict also barriers, so we can calculating these barriers accurately gives us an idea of the kind of perturbation that we have to alter the phase of a system, and very importantly, they are predictive. And this is in constant in contrast with other semi-empirical methods where you need to input a lot of information or complex information that comes from experiments. With respect to excited states, they do so and so depending on the method that you use. And the big problems appear when you want to do temperature, when you are trying to work with non-abiotic problems, or when you are trying to make big systems. As the scaling, usually n cubed, is quite bad, and that limits the amount of atoms that you can have in your simulation. Okay? But most important of all is that, okay, they give us a wealth of information that is difficult to get from the experiment, so it's very useful to complement experiments. What's the problem? Where do we find limitations to those first principles? So essentially, when we go to the nanoscale, since most DFT calculations are going to work on the 1 nanometer scale, that is where we have the limit for our size in simulation, in DFT, when we try to simulate the skirmions like this one, which is, it has a scale of tens of nanometers, or you go to try to simulate a nanowire like this one, where you see here this is 200 nanometers. So this is out of the kind of system that we can do in first principles. Also, when we go to try to simulate non-equilibrium states, where we want to include long wavelength phonons, so it's clear that we cannot do that directly in a full simulation with DFT. Or we want to study charge diffusion, that is also difficult in DFT. Or we want to study disorder, that is again entering in this kind of problem with temperature. Both when we want to simulate domains, we want to simulate a thermal disorder, or we want to simulate effects. Also, the idea is that we want to simulate perturbations in an experiment. Usually what you do is you have a system and you apply a perturbation. It may be an increase of temperature or a decrease, or you want to apply fields. That is also usually difficult to do in DFT. And most experiments are carried in room temperature, something that you cannot do with it. So all these problems are important, and we want to have the computational tool to attack them. So in the history of computational physics, of course, many of these systems of these problems have been approached by using model Hamiltonians. And I'd say the most archetypical of them is perhaps the Heisenberg Hamiltonian for spins, that where you have a Hamiltonian that is simple, like this one, and this allows you to treat very large systems, usually of the 10 to the 4th or 10 to the 5 spins in your simulation cell. You can do finite temperatures, so you can sample your microstates and you can calculate what happens with the system as you change temperature. But the problem, this is not without problem. What are the main difficulties? So this is coarse grained. Magnetism is associated to electrons, and when you use a Hamiltonian with this, you are losing track of what those electrons are doing. And also, when you increase your temperature, you have phonons, and perhaps you can somehow include the effect of those phonons in an effective way in your constant. But still, this is a coarse-grained approach, and you don't know what's the effect of the temperature on these constants, and perhaps you have to introduce the effect of the geometry on the coupling constant in an effective way there in order to get accurate results. So we see here a second problem of a problem of using model Hamiltonians. How do we parameterize them? That is a key problem, and it's going to be at least half of the course we are going to devote it to how we generate the second principle models out of first principle simulations. Okay? So the model Hamiltonians, the complications. So what are the foundations of the model? What are the physics that went into creating this expression? Second, how do we determine the parameters? So when you get the parameters from experiment, something that you can do, we call the model semi-empirical, and we adopted the term second principles to models of this kind that some have some physical foundation, and then you obtain the parameters from first principles. And then, well, there's the limitation of which properties it can be applied to. So first principles in principle can be applied to any property, but some of these model Hamiltonians are limited to a particular material property. In this case, magnets. Some other model Hamiltonians are going to be applied to phonon properties. So the idea is that this is a limitation, and we won't go beyond that. And also, so the physical foundations means that some of these models may just be, they can just be storing information, or they may be able to predict new phases or new properties, which is, I think, what we expect out of a physical model. And also, there is the problem of the accuracy. Okay, so for us, the two main problems are going to be, so how should we build the model? For us, the foundation of the model should be a first principle theory that allows us to describe as many properties in material science as possible. And second, if that theory, as it's going to be, has parameters, how do we get those parameters in order to be as realistic as possible? Okay, so what we want at the end is being predictive, so we are going to be based on DFT, and we want well-defined physics, so all the constants are going to be obtained from Hamiltonian. An idea of this kind of Hamiltonian is found of the lattice Hamiltonian that have been used for already for a long time, for example, in order to carry out large-scale simulations of ferroelectrics. So these Hamiltonians contain two terms that include as variables the local distortions in each of the cells, so this resembles a little bit the Heisenberg Hamiltonian, and these modes are obtained from a phonon sequence. And then they include an electrostatic part where there are dipole-dipole interactions, so long-range dipole-dipole interactions, and these are obtained from first principles from the bond charges obtained from out of first principles. And then the short range include the polynomial expansion, and those parameters are again obtained from a few first principle calculations. So this is essentially the grandparent of the kind of models that we want to use. So they are based, they have electrostatics, so that is something that is going to allow you to do a lot of prediction. And then you have something that is fitted to first principles. So these models allow you to go to large time and space scales. They allow you to have statistics, and they allow you to simulate domains and superlattices, for example. But again, they have problems in the sense that they include idealized degrees of freedom. They don't describe all the atoms in the system. So for the initial problems, like lead titanate or barium titanate, where, for example, octahedral rotation in perovskites were not so important, these were very good. But then we nowadays want to simulate more complicated systems. Perhaps the most complicated and more interesting is bismuth ferrite. But we know that bismuth ferrite first has magnetic properties, which this doesn't include. There are groups that include that have effective Hamiltonians, including. But we want to include them in a more general way. And they don't include electrons. So, for example, you cannot simulate charge domain groups, things like that. So, we want to have something that can go beyond this kind of approach. So, how do we get to carry out larger or first principle simulations in a faster way? So, the idea is that when you are creating first principle simulation, your Hamiltonian grows very fast with the number of electrons. In fact, with the number of basis functions that are in your system. So this goes with n squared. And you usually employ diagonalization methods that go with like n to the cube. So this is slow and doesn't allow you to go farther than, let's say, 1 or 2,000 atoms. But when you are trying to discuss the properties of a material, in fact, what you are looking at is usually small changes in the electronic structure. So you don't want to simulate all the electrons. What you want to capture is just these small changes in a few electrons or in a few electrons and holes that contain the main physics of your system. So the idea for the second principles that we are going to use is we want something that can describe essentially the accuracy of a full DFT simulation, but we can select how many degrees of freedom we want to introduce, down to the idea of a model Hamiltonian like the ones we were discussing for the ferroelectrics. So one of the first things that we need is we want to select the fidelity of our calculations to a full DFT simulation. We want to make it efficient, and we want to find the parameters that allow us to go from a full DFT, the model Hamiltonian, to light. And so since our basis is going to be the full DFT simulations, we call these second principles DFT methods. So density functional theory is going to be our foundation for the method. So now the point is, okay, so we want to reproduce DFT. So how do we extract these excitations out of the full DFT where you have all the electrons? So the idea is, or the best way to think about this is to think an insulator. So you have your full valence band and your completely empty conduction band, and then you dope the system with an electron. So you introduce this electron, and of course, you immediately can think that for a particular geometry, you could make simulation of the system without the extra electron, so you have the perfect balance and the perfect conduction band, and then you have the effect of this electron. So you have to describe the density of the extra electron and how this electron deforms the density inside your material. So the idea is the perfect insulator density, we are going to call it a reference, and we are going to call it N0, and then we are going to have this extra electron with the screening of the density that we are going to call the deformation density. And so this is the main, this is going to represent the excitations that we wanted to describe here. Okay, and these are these, when you integrate this N0, this is going to give you all the electrons in silico. So a very big quantity, but we, when we integrate this deformation density, it's going to integrate to one electron. So it's easier to track and compare. Okay? So how do we proceed? So the idea is now that we have this expression, we go to the full DFT energy and we plug this expression in here. So the idea is that we want to separate the terms that go with N0 and the terms that go with the deformation density. So that's relatively easy, except for the exchange and correlation energy that can be, is non-linear and it can be quite difficult. So the idea is that we are going to follow, this is already found in many papers before what we did, on essentially this is the basis of tie-binding DFT, and you have here one of the main references. And what you do is you expand your exchange correlation energy in terms of the deformation density. So you have a first term that goes with the reference density, and then you have a first, second, third term that goes within the deformation. Okay? So at the end, our energy in second principles is going to be an expansion, and we are, and this expansion systematically approximates the full DFT energy. However, the way we group the perturbations and the way we build the perturbation of the reference is different from the tie-binding DFT talks. So now the idea is that when we carry out simulations for materials, we usually use different construction blocks to make our simulation. So when we go to first principle, this is clear, the atoms are our construction blocks. If you do plane waves, what you have to provide is the your code is with pseudo-potentials, and the pseudo-potentials are atoms. So in order to build a material, you need to give pseudo-potentials that are essentially atomic representations, and with that you build your material. Tie-binding DFT does something like that. So the idea is that it has atomic bases, and it constructs a model out of atomic properties. Okay, what happens with that? So your E0 are going to be your atomic cores. But anytime you want to correct the energy of those atomic cores, you have to sum your E1, you have to sum over all the electrons. And then you have the electron-electron interactions contained in E2. Okay, but then calculating the basic energy of your system requires summing over all the electrons. Okay, so the idea in those methods is that you start from your atoms, you go to your first principle code, and then you obtain the material properties. So second principles for us is going to take it from here. For us, the building block is going to be a full simulation of a particular material. So A0, which is going to be what we call the lattice energy, is just going to be the unperturbed energy of your system. And then E1, E2, and all the others are going to be electron excitations associated to the deformation. So the idea is that we take, as a construction block, the material, and from there we go to large scale. What's the catch? So this is not free. The idea is that when you start from atoms, you are worried about capturing this energy with a lot of accuracy. So you sacrifice, so you can, and in this energy we have, you have the bonding energy. So the bonding energy, the ability to capture the bonding energy, is very expensive from the computational side. We don't capture the bonding energy, so we are not going to be able to break the bonds and do, for example, chemistry on a surface. But the idea is that we are going to be much more accurate than tight binding DFT. That the energies in tight binding DFT are relatively accurate. While we are going to make a big effort in getting very accurate energies for our material around a particular geometry. So the idea is that second principles DFT is going to be as accurate as DFT if we don't go very far from a particular configuration. So the main problem is that we are not going to describe bonding. Okay? So we call that the main approximation for second principle DFT is that the topology for the bonds is fixed. So you cannot just dissociate the model. But that doesn't mean that we cannot have a strong distortions. So for example, in a perovskite like lead titanate, you have distortions that are significant in the sense that you have half an astral distortion or of the other half an astral distortion. So we can have large distortions, but not distortions that destroy completely bonds. Okay? So how do each of these terms look? So when you look to the reference energy, E0, this is just the full DFT energy for the reference density. Which means that there are no approximations. If we are able to somehow describe E0 in the same way as DFT, with the accuracy of DFT, we are doing the same as the DFT calculation. The idea here is that we are not going to do a full DFT calculation to obtain this energy, because of course that would be too expensive. The idea is that we are going to represent this energy with a very accurate force field. Okay? And that is one of the main papers of the methods implemented in scale-up. So this force field will be described in a lot of detail by Jorge this afternoon, and the idea is that we can represent the energy surface of the ground state of a system accurately. Okay? And then we enter into correcting this force field when we go out of the reference density, when we start adding perturbation. So when you go to the expression, is this one, where O, these O's are the occupation of particular block functions, and this is the reference. So in fact, what you are doing here is you are doing the difference between the eigen functions of the reference Hamiltonian for the deform wave functions with respect to the eigen functions or the expectation value of the reference one electron Hamiltonian with respect to the eigen functions of the reference Hamiltonian. When we express this in a binary basis, and we'll go on the binary basis tomorrow and in more detail on Thursday, then you can change this expression into this one, where this capital D is just the density matrix representing the deformation density on the basis of the Banier functions, which are this chi A and chi B, and then you have this gamma AB, which is just the Hamiltonian expressing the Banier basis. So essentially this is just a tie binding scheme. So at the end, E1, the first correction to the energy, is some kind of tie binding scheme. It's going to have the shape of a tie binding scheme. And this represents the excitation of an electron and a hole from the valence to the conduction. Okay? And then the second order term represents the interaction between two electrons. The third would be between three electrons and so on. And the shape it takes is just an effective interaction between two densities, two deformation densities. And when we express it in our Banier basis, it takes this shape, where we see the constants that are going to go into our model, which is this U and this I. So the idea is U controls what happens when the spin up and spin down deformation densities are added. So essentially when we add electrons, or when we remove electrons from our system, and we call this the Hubbard constant. And if you check the I, this goes with the difference of the spin densities. So this controls spin polarization. So any magnetic system is going to depend strongly on this constant, on this part of the Hamilton. Okay? So once we have that, we have, in principle, what is implemented in a scale-up cuts here. And the idea then is that we have a method that is accurate, that is able to represent the bands with the one electron part of the Hamiltonian. It can represent metals, because those bands can be occupied in any way. And it can also capture things like magnetism, or what happens when you dope a system with the I and the U constants. Okay? So in principles, this is the full Hamiltonian that we are going to use. So what does it make it fast? Because if you look attentively at the full expressions, you can see that these expressions are essentially and formally the same as Hartree-Fock. So, but we know that Hartree-Fock is a pretty slow method that scales with n to the 5, because you need to calculate. When you look at these constants, you have four indexes, and if each of these four indexes run over all the bases of your system, this is going to scale really badly. So, on the other hand, DFT goes like n to the cube with local exchange functional based on diagonalization. What would make second principles go very fast? So the idea is that if we look at these integrals, we would have a four index integral here, so essentially we are on the same level of Hartree-Fock. But the thing is that our models are not going to be fast if we include all the constants, if we go essentially to the Hartree-Fock. The idea is that our models are going to effectively represent a first principle simulation, and they are going to include a smaller thing. And then we are going to use techniques that allow us to rapidly find the density associated to these Hamiltonians, And we'll discuss that as we go. But essentially, the idea that our Hamiltonians are limited in range is a key thing in order to find fast solutions to the electron structure problem. Okay. So how can we limit the range in our models? So one of the key things that we need to introduce is not just a plane divided or a plane Hubbard model like here, but we need to introduce electrostatics. So the idea that we are going to use is that our electrons in our system are going to be localized in Barnier functions that, as you know, are usually within one unit cell, concentrated within one unit cell. So the idea is that from far away, instead of seeing the full shape of an orbital, you can approximate the density associated with this orbital with a multipolar expansion. So the idea is that we are going to transform our electrostatics into a problem of point charges and dipoles. And that is, and part of our constant in our method, the gamma and the U, for example, are going to contain electrostatic contributions that come from interactions of charges and dipoles. Of course, so what is the origin of the charges? The origin of the charges is going to be just transference of charge from some orbitals to another, and the origin of the dipoles are going to be atomic displacements. So we are going to introduce at some point bond charges in order to see the polarization created by the displacement of one atom, and of course hybridization between orbitals. So our orbitals are not going to be frozen, but they can mix with each other and they can hybridize in order to create local dipoles where the electron density is different. Okay, we'll just see how this is introduced in specialized talks this afternoon and tomorrow. Okay, so the idea is that at long range, our parameters are going to go to be replaced by the electrostatics. Okay, so what have we done so far with second principles? So the idea is that in order to see what we can do, if you check, for example, the defect density on a typical semiconductor, so between 10 to 13 centimeters to the square of 10 to the 18. So when you go to first principles, you can make in the largest system, let's say 700, a 3 nanometer square cube. That means that you are in a density of 10 to the 19, so too large to simulate this. But in second principles, we've been able to go up to 60,000 atoms, and that means 15 nanometer cube. So we are already in the range of that typical semiconductor defect density. So what are the keys and where we expect to improve? So short range Hamiltonian means that we can use linear scaling techniques. In particular, we are working on self-consistent with just the density matrix instead of diagonalizing the full one electron Hamiltonian, and that is going to give us hopefully the tool to go further than this. And from the technical side, working on parallelization techniques for the electron. Okay, so how do we want to work with second principles? So the idea is that starting from first principles, we are going to create material models, and from these material models that are our blocks to work here, we are going to carry out second principle essentially with techniques associated to dynamics, not so much with diagonalization, so we are going to go to be faster than typical techniques in first principles, and then we are going to include temperature, pressure, electric fields and defects in the simulation. We are going to be able to impose constraints in order to obtain structure transitions, conductivity, dielectric constants, mobility of systems, and we can simulate diffusion of charge and so on, or thermoelectricity, or any property that you can think from just a single package. Okay, so the package is called Scale Up. You already have a copy of the code in the your computer. We'll discuss distribution, our distribution policy on Friday, but the idea is that everyone who comes to the to this workshop can use it. Why? Essentially because these methods are in development. They are not a black box, so essentially you can nowadays come to a first principle code almost with no training. You can go, you can look at a couple tutorials in a web page or in YouTube, and you can start running, and probably your results will be correct. That is not so in second principle. So all the methods are being developed, and particularly delicate is the creation of the models. So hopefully when you go back home after this workshop, you have at least an idea of how to create models and how to test them and how to check that they are reliable, because that is a big problem using second principles. Or on the other hand, it's important to be very careful, because in principle the code can admit any parameter that you supply it. So it doesn't matter how exotic the property you want to reproduce or you want to predict, the code with the proper parameters will give you an answer. Whether that answer is correct or not depends critically on whether you generated your model property and you checked it in the proper circumstances. So hopefully that is one of the main things that you will come out with out of the work. So the idea is that in the code you have fully integrated electron and lattice models. You can use one, the other, or both combined. Right now it's able to do single points, it can do dynamics, some flavor of dynamics at least, and Monte Carlo. You have self-consistent field with convergent accelerators. You have a time-dependent DFT code in there, so you can do excited states. We are not going to discuss much about this. On Friday, we may see a little bit how it's used. There are some tutorials on how to use it. And the code, the internal part of the code is essentially a Fortran 90 code with Python utilities and a Python interface around it to help you use it. The parallelization uses a hybrid scheme with MPI and OpenMP. Here we are going to be using the serial and the OpenMP. The MPI is right now under reconstruction, so it's not very reliable. Okay. And main things that we are going to use are the utilities that are very important to analyze all your results. A difference with first principles, where you plot your cell with VESTA, and it's very easy to immediately capture the relevant distances, for example, how they change. Here you may have a cell with tens of thousands of atoms, so going one by one, checking the distances is not going to be a practical way of doing things. So these tools are really a very important part of the code. And also we'll be discussing the model building suit. This is going to be Wednesday and Thursday, and this is a main part of the talk. Okay. And on Friday we'll discuss how far we've gone with the code and what are our intentions for the future. So I can already tell you that we are planning on a spin orbit on what we call chemical inhomogeneity, that is going to be able to describe surfaces, interfaces, impurities, and many things that may be important in your research, okay? And of course, some technical implementations, like the polarization of this density matrix that will allow us to go in larger systems, okay? So, that's the first session. So